exit today by dropping in the buckets with our ushers in the back. Or heading to our website. It's easy, it's fast, and it's simple, and we thank you for your generosity.
Hello and welcome to Grace Church. Our mission at Grace is to help people grow in their relationship with Christ. If you haven't already, we invite you to stop by one of our kiosks on the plaza to say hello and introduce yourself. We can't wait to get to know you better. We have a new group starting on April the 17th. It's a 6-week course for grandparenting, just like the series that ended that was during the day. This one's gonna be at night, starting at 7 o'clock on April the 17th in Building D, led by Larry and Sharon Keene. For more information, contact Sharon and she'll bring you up to speed on what you need for this great course on grandparenting.
It's time to start a party! VBS registration opens next Sunday. Now, VBS is a week-long party where over 700 kids come ages 4 through 6th grade here on campus July 8th through the 12th and learn why Jesus gives us the most amazing reason to celebrate, to have a party. We truly believe that God's love and the gospel is worth celebrating, and we're gonna do that all summer long. So Grace family, please hear me. Registration fills up fast. Don't wait until the following Monday to register. Nope, register next Sunday. We cannot wait to have your kids be a part of our fun party summer. Are you ready for a little fun this summer? Because we need you. Yes, we are doing VBS this summer and we need party starters. Are you a party starter? I've got my party starter earrings on, ready to go. We are in need of your help. We will have over 700 kids on our campus this summer and we can't have them be here all by themselves. So come and join us, come join the team, come serve with us. There are many different ways in which you can serve, but we need you, you party starters, to come join the party today.
If you haven't already, make sure you go follow us on all social media platforms at Grace Church of Glendora. No matter where you're at, we want you to know that we are here for you and that we have a place for you here. You're not here by accident, and we are so excited that you're here. Welcome home, Grace Church.
Well, welcome home, Grace. We are so glad you are here today. If you are a guest with us for the very first time, well, welcome. We are glad that you are with us. We would love to get to know you. We have a gift for you. If you would go after service out onto the plaza and to our little kiosk there, this little cart, just let us know that you're here for the first time. We have a gift for you and love to just connect with you that way. Every Sunday, we take an offering. Our family believes that part of our worship expression is giving. And currently, we are in a 3-week giving campaign to raise money for summer camp. And so thank you so much for those of you that have given so far to our giving campaign. We'll show a video in just a moment. We are 1/3 of the way there. So in 1 week, so thank you, family. That is amazing. That helps so many families go to camp. So we thank you for your generosity. But let's watch this video and let you know that giving is a part of our worship.
I love camp because I have the time to spend time with all my leaders, meet new kids, have lots of fun, make new friends, and spend time with kids I don't know yet and learn so much about God.
Camp has shaped my relationship with God because He told me that we need to love each other as a community as much as we love Him. We might not think the same way, but we might love the same way, and we all need to understand and learn that.
Camp has shaped my relationship with the Lord by reminding me that He's the only one that I need, and that when I go down the mountain, there's all the distractions do not define me and everything around me, and I always have Him, and He'll always be with me.
Something I will never forget from camp is going ziplining for the first time. It was really fun, and I did it with one of my best friends. And it was like a really good experience because you got to see everything and got to see the mountains, the views, and it was really fun.
One memory from camp that I'll never forget is when we're all worshiping together as one at camp.
We are asking you, our church family, to help us lower the cost of camp so more kids can go. Forced home prices are $5.15 for kids and $6.99 for students. Our goal this year is to raise $35,000, which will significantly reduce the individual camper cost for $385 for kids and $475 for students. This amount will also provide transportation to and from camp, pay for our counselors' registration as they serve our kids and students for a complete week. If you give online, would you select Camp Fundraiser in the giving dropdown? And if you give via check, would you write Summer Camp on the memo line? We are so grateful for your extreme generosity in sending kids to camp.
Amen. So thank you for giving. We are going to transition into child dedication. So if you are here and you are dedicating your littles, would you come on up, please? We'll give them a moment to come on up all the way across these beautiful families. So fun to do dedication. Part of our commitment here at Grace Church is to partner with parents. And we recognize that we as a church have a very small, you can come over this way, guys. Come this way so you don't have to step. We have a very small window of opportunity to pour, and a short amount of hours, truly, to pour into the lives of the kids. But the primary faith influencers in the life of children are the parents. They're the ones that spend all the waking moments with them, right? And they are the ones that pour into spiritually. And so what a gift it is for Grace Church to be able to partner with parents, to cue them and equip them and have these milestone moments where we get to say, hey, let's just talk. Let's journey on this road together as parents. Two things we talk about in dedication class is the importance of making every week count to when we are more intentional with the time that we have, we tend to do better with it. And so we give every family a marble jar, and every marble represents the week in the life of a kid. There are approximately 936 weeks from the time a child is born to the time they graduate high school. And we're not going to be perfect parents, and we're not going to have every moment be perfect, but we can do something every week to impact the lives of our kids spiritually, physically, socially, and emotionally. And so we give this as a reminder to them. The other thing that we talk about in dedication class is the importance of widening our circle. Every one of our kids needs more than just mom and dad's voice in their life. They need a minimum of 5 people that know their name and know their story and can journey with them. And that's why I'm so thankful here at Grace Church. The partnership is so important. Because starting in preschool, we start connect groups in 3 and 4 and 5-year-olds, where we take prayer requests and we eat fishy crackers, and it moves all the way up into adulthood. So by the time they graduate, people know who they are, they know their story, and they journey with them together. Because let's be honest, we don't want a parent alone, and it's important to have that partnership. So today, we have these awesome families that are here for dedication. And so let's start with Lily and Liam. Why don't you come up here? If you don't know, this is my husband, Josh. Most of you know him, but just to make sure, I want to make sure you know who's up here. And together, we are going to pray. Do you see those marbles? They're so pretty, huh? All right, so let's start with Lily. Lily, we are so thankful for you. So, Father, thank you for Lily Jewel. Thank you for creating her on purpose and for a purpose. Thank you that your plans for Lily are good and that you are going to give her a hope and a future. Lord, we ask that you speak loudly to her as she's little and learning. Would she hear your voice? Would she grow in understanding of you from a very young age? Would she come to know you as her Lord and Savior? And Father, would you give mom and dad wisdom as they raise her and train her and point her to you? God, would they rely on you to navigate this journey of parenting? So, Father, today we dedicate sweet Lily Jewel to you. We dedicate her parents to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
And this is Liam. Will you guys stretch your hands out to them, please? Father, we thank you for Liam Samuel. We ask that he would draw near to you at a young age. Our prayer is that he would trust you with his whole life, with his whole heart early on. That he would grow and that you would give him insight and wisdom. Guard his heart and his mind as he grows into the man of God that you have for him to be. Show him the path that you have for him at an early age. We pray that he becomes a lover of your truth, the Bible, and that you, Father, would be the source of his life. We ask that you would bless Dad and Mom as they raise him. Would they continue to point Liam to you and to your word, and that they would introduce the Holy Spirit to him. We dedicate them, the whole family, to you today, Jesus. We thank you that you are our Lord and our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Viviana, are you ready? We're going to do a little switching on the stage. Look it. She's so cute. Aren't you so precious? So my little one that's now 24 would not allow me to dress her like this at Viviana's age. She just wouldn't have it. So I love it. I have just such fond memories. And it's been fun to watch you guys grow because I've known you for a bit. So should we pray for you today and for your parents? Is that okay? Okay. All right. Lord, would you stretch out your hands? Lord, today we dedicate Viviana to you, Father. We thank you that you created her in her mother's womb and that she is fearfully and wonderfully made. Thank you for creating her for your glory. Lord, we pray that Viviana would hear your voice at a very young age like Samuel did in your word, and that she would follow your ways all the days of her life. Protect her as she grows. Give her wisdom and maturity to see what you're doing in the world around her. Would she be bold in her faith from a very young age, and give her parents wisdom as they steward her precious life. Lord, today we dedicate the whole family, Viviana, Mom, and Dad, to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. Come on over, guys.
This is Piper.
Hi, Piper. You say hi to everybody? Okay.
Well, why don't you stretch your hands out? Father, we just thank you so much for Piper. We thank you that you are an amazing God. We thank you that your blessings are beyond our understanding. And we thank you for Piper Reese. We thank you that she is blessed. To have such an amazing family. Lord, we pray that she would come to know you as a young girl. And that she would walk in your ways all the days of her life. Would Piper grow up to be a Christ-centered woman who trusts you with all of her heart.
Holy Spirit, give her a heart of compassion that reflects your compassion to the world around her. And as she grows, would you continue to strengthen the relationship with her sisters so they would have a bond like no other? Would you, Holy Spirit, give her a heart of generosity to share with the world the giftings that you have given to her? And Father, put a hedge of protection around her as she grows. Would she learn at an early age to put on the full armor of God so she is ready to walk through this life that's in front of her? We dedicate her and her parents and her sisters to you today in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who came in the flesh. Amen.
Thanks, family.
Hi, Grace Church. I'm Jim Burns. I'm a fan of this church. I love this church. And I'm excited you have a new pastor coming, but I'm also excited that this staff, I pointed at Amber, but so many others, has pulled this off. It's a great thing. And today, seeing this baby dedication, Josh, you made me cry when you kind of got all emotional. What's up? She's supposed to cry. You're supposed to, like, be tough. No, it's the other way around. That's the way in our family, too. I have a photo in my office that has me at our church. I'm not a pastor at my church, but I'm a pastor. And so I was dedicating Charlotte, my 6-year-old granddaughter. And I was dedicating Charlotte, and I was holding Charlotte, and I was next to my daughter. I was next to then her husband, Steve, who we love. And then she's holding Charlotte, and then James and Charlotte are holding hands. James had already been dedicated. And I just love that story. And then you mentioned Vacation Bible School. So this last summer, I was speaking at a conference in Oregon, and our church was having Vacation Bible School, and I get a call from James. He's 8, so he's not totally great phone perfect, but he calls up and he goes, "Papa Jay?" And I said, "James, what are you doing calling me?" This may be the first call he'd ever called. He said, "Papa Jay, real formal, I wanted you to know that tonight I crossed the line and Jesus became my forever friend at Vacation Bible School." Papa Jay starts crying, and then he says, "And I need $150 for the church mission program." I went, this kid is going to be a television evangelist, right? So I said, "James, you got that." But I'm crying. I go, "James, you got the money." I said, "Have you told Grandma yet?" And she said, "No." So I said, "You got to call Grandma and tell Grandma too," because she wasn't with me where I was speaking. So he calls Grandma and he said, "I made Jesus my forever friend and I need $150. So he got $300 from us. So Kathy calls me up and she's like, "Oh, James, did he talk to you?" And I said, "Yeah, he did. We talk about all the spiritual part." And then she goes, "Oh, and by the way, I gave him $150 for the church mission thing." And I went, "Wait, I gave him $150 too." I go, "He's totally a television evangelist." But anyway, perfect today to talk about what I'm going to talk about as we think about children. Even in terms of seeing the 936 weeks from the time a child is born until the time a child graduates. I mean, that's just freaky. Some people love that. I have my daughter, Heidi, who has 2 kids. I send her about every week. I'm on an app that Amber would be on, that where you see, and my grandkids' pictures are there. And I said, "Hey, you know, you only got, you know, he just went from 900s to the 800s. And Heidi goes, "Quit sending me these. This is driving me nuts." And then about a month later, she goes, "Hey, how many more weeks, you know? He's kind of, we had a bad week with him and, you know, blah, blah, blah." And I said, "Well, do you want me to send it to you again?" She goes, "Yeah, you can send it." And then about another 3 weeks, she goes, "Don't send me these anymore." You know, so it's kind of fun. But living life on purpose. You know, we don't talk a lot about purpose. Most of you are trying to live your life with purpose. These beautiful families who stood up here, part of their purpose is to dedicate their children to the Lord. They're not going to do it perfect. No family is perfect. There is not one family in here that's perfect, including moi, right here. And yet, most people do try to live their life on purpose. Like I said, none perfect. Some of our loved ones are forfeiting their spiritual purpose. And frankly, I would say that some of you are. I know that there are times when I've sure drifted, and I forfeit my spiritual purpose. So I want to think about the idea of purpose. And sometimes your plans change, but oftentimes your purpose does not change. And I think a purpose is deeper, is more spiritual, is more a relationship with God, but we probably seldom think about our purpose. Because a lot of times when we think about purpose, we think about our vocation, which is only a small part of our purpose. Part of our purpose for these parents was at that baby dedication, they said our purpose is to help our kids grow in faith, see? And yet again, we kind of miss that because there's other kinds of purposes that get in the way. Now, I've got a quiz for you, and Mark, who I think is in the other service. Is he in the other service? Good. Okay, so whoever wins this, he's going to give fast food vouchers for the rest of your life. So anyway, just go talk to Mark about that. Here's a song. Tell me what movie this song is from. You get a better chance if you're over 40. Maestro? Okay, this guy right here said Chariots of Fire before it started. What'd you do? Were you upstairs when we were looking at this or something? Good job. Hear that song? Chariots of Fire. I love this song. I mean, I love this. Well, I love the song, but I love the movie. Now, some of you who are under 40, you have no idea what I'm even talking about because it was a, you know, award-winning movie years ago. You can turn the deal off now if you want. But Kathy and I went to a movie to see something else, and we went, oh, we heard this was kind of good, too, and we went, so we knew nothing about that movie when it first came out, and we were blown away. And it's actually a movie about purpose, okay? And in this movie, you've got Eric Lindell, who is a runner, and yet he's called, and his purpose in life was to go to the mission field in China, and he was torn. Because he really ran fast. He was from Great Britain, and he was in the Olympics. And he didn't run on Sunday, which was amazing. So he actually, they had a time to run on Sunday, and he said, I can't do that. That's probably not a lot of us right now. My grandson is at a baseball game right now, right as we speak. He had a 9:45 game. And that's kind of the way life goes. But Eric Lindell said no. But the fascinating side to Eric was that his sister came in the middle of this movie and said, you know, what are you doing running? You know, aren't you called to China? And he said something very interesting. Here's his quote. I believe that God made me for a purpose, for China. He became a missionary, by the way. But he also made me fast, and when I run, I feel God's pleasure. That's an incredible statement. Do you ever feel God's pleasure? If you feel God's pleasure at all times, then you are the first person I've ever heard, because there are times we just don't feel God's pleasure. I feel God's pleasure when I'm in line with my purpose. I felt God's pleasure today watching this. I felt God's pleasure today when I left my house at Dana Point, took a look at the beach, saw the ocean. It was beautiful today, beautiful weather. Came up here and saw those mountains that I love here. I went to Azusa Pacific, so, you know, it's been a long time. When the girl had, she was virtually the best class ever in, you know, 2021, the worship person, I was the virtually best class in 1971, which is 50 years. I'm 50 years older than her. I didn't feel as cool and groovy as she looked. But what I'm saying is, do you feel God's pleasure in your purpose? Because I think God has something to say and be within our purpose. And again, I love the story of what he said when he said, I believe that God made me for a purpose, for China, but he also made me fast. And when I run, I feel God's pleasure. Now, I have the audacity to believe it. You know, I've sensed God's purpose at times. For me, it was when I was 16. I wasn't raised in the Christian church. I became a Christian, the first Christian in my family. And when I became a Christian, I sensed that God's hand was on my life. I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know who I was going to be. I didn't know where I was going to go. I didn't know who I was going to marry, of course. All those kinds of things. But I sensed that was a part of God's purpose. 1 week after college graduation, Kathy and I got married, which I don't always recommend. I wrote a book called Getting Ready for Marriage. It was actually for a 27-year-old and a 29-year-old, not a 20 and a 21-year-old. But I sensed that God was a part of that. And we have what we call a high maintenance marriage, so it hasn't been necessarily the easiest. We're speaking not next week, but the following week at a big conference. It's actually already sold out just to hear Kathy and me, and we just absolutely laugh at this because, you know, there are moments when we wondered if we were actually going to make it in our marriage, and now we speak on marriage, which is kind of funny. Three kids, all girls, by the way. Where's the family that has all the, oh, wow. Can I just stop and pray for you, sir? You know. Here's your secret. Every morning when they get to be teens and they're all kind of, you know, just you start by saying, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, and then go on. And with your wife, you say, I'm sorry, and you got it, okay? That's your secret, okay? But anyway, three daughters, four grandkids, all a major part of my life purpose, and actually things I hadn't thought about when I became a Christian when I was 16. But today, those are more a part of my purpose than even some of my vocational type stuff. My work, vocation, you have a vocation, most of you. And in your vocation, whatever it would be, some of you are stay-at-home, you know, parents. But whatever you are, you have a vocation, and your vocation is part of it. And like I said before, sometimes God changes his plans, but he seldom changes his purpose. So what I hope by the end of this is that you'll be more in touch with your purpose. To be called is often misunderstood. To have your purpose known is to be often misunderstood because it's very spiritual, and yet it's not flashy. And so sometimes I think we wait for the big flash. A light comes into our eyes, we fall off of our bed, and we say, oh, I'm supposed to go to China. When in fact, it's rather more about your day-to-day, sometimes in the monotony of our lives, is that we meet God's purpose. See. Now, unfortunately, some people forfeit their purpose. I was writing a book. I wrote a book, and it's a book that's my most well-known book. It's called Doing Life with Your Adult Children, Keep Your Mouth Shut, and the Welcome Mat Out, which you don't need to buy the book because I pretty much just told you what the book's all about. And in there, I talk about the fact that a lot of parents who have adult children have their kids stray from faith, violate values. And so I created something called The Anatomy of a Lost Faith, okay? And I'm going to show you this. In this, I called it an atrophied faith, which, you know, sometimes is too fancy of a word, but atrophy means that, you know, if I haven't been working out, you know, my muscles are going to get, you know, flabby. And sometimes that happens with our spiritual life. And interesting enough, before we get into the part of how do we find purpose and how do we live with our purpose, I want you to see this because I think this is the story for at least some of you, and you know someone who's doing this right now. Number one is we neglect our faith. So the story is, and Amber lives with this very much, just as I do, that when kids leave the church after high school, that a number, 65% of them oftentimes now leave the faith for a while. They come back at marriage, they come back at when they make babies, you know, things like that. But first of all, we neglect. And all of us at times can neglect our faith. People neglected their faith during COVID, and some never came back to their faith. It's kind of a scary thing, but they just neglected. They aren't evil people. They aren't rotten people. They're not, you know, big immoral, you know, bums. What they are is they're people who neglected their faith, and that got them in touch or out of touch with their spiritual purpose, okay? Secondly, after they neglect for a while, then they drift. It's just normal. It's natural. What happens is you neglect, and then you drift. And really, what we want to do to is make a course correction quickly, but a lot of us, when it comes to our purpose, don't make course corrections, and so we keep drifting. I live in Dana Point, and in Dana Point, if I got on a boat and I was going to go to Hawaii and I was just off by 1%, that boat would end up in Australia, right? And so I'm totally going to miss Hawaii. Well, so for a lot of people, they and you can identify with me because maybe this has been you or maybe this is someone that you know, is you neglect, you drift, and then you go into unbelief or what I'm going to call lack of trust. So when you go into unbelief or lack of trust, it's not because, you know, you hate God. It's not because you weren't dedicated or baptized or whatever your thing is. You might become a Christian at a certain age like me, but you just simply, you know, move into unbelief or lack of faith. You're not working that muscle or you're not working the faith muscle. So what happens is you're beginning the process of forfeiting your spiritual purpose. You're not there yet, okay? And then you move to disobedience. And so when people move to disobedience, you see this a lot of times in college. For most of us, some of us it might have been in college or the workforce when we got to be adults, but you know, you become disobedient. Jesus said something very, very interesting. He said, if you love me, wow, if I love you, well, what would I do? If you love me, you will obey me. And if you obey me, I will reveal myself to you. So oftentimes, this principle, there's a principle in Scripture, that Scripture, that revelation of God comes through our obedience. So if people are not flexing that muscle and it's getting flabby and then they become disobedient, what do they do? Well, you only have two options. One is to come back and be obedient. The other is to change your morals and values. So we've got a whole group of people today who have just changed. I don't believe in God anymore because they have done something that is immoral from what the biblical worldview would be. And so now they say, okay, I'm in this place, so I either have to change my belief system or I have to come back. And so we've got people, adults, young adults especially, but everybody, who just changes their belief system. It's the easier way to go. I was talking with somebody this weekend, a young 30s-something young woman who's friends with my family, and she basically says, I can't buy this stuff in the Bible anymore. I mean, she grew up in the church. She grew up, we had Fellowship of Christian Athletes at our house. She went to Fellowship of Christian Athletes. I mean, she goes, I just can't buy this. And she's much more woke, if you would, but she goes, I can't buy this anymore. Well, that started with some disobedience in her life that she was going to have to come to grips with, or she was going to have to change her belief system. She's changed her belief system. How's that working for her? Not good. Because the reason she talked to me was because of an imminent divorce that's going to take place because of some poor choices. And so we play out, it plays out farther and farther, see. So disobedience. Then we have what I like to call insensitivity to God, or the Bible calls it dull of hearing. So what happens is you've been neglecting, you've been drifting, you've been, you know, you're in an unbelief state, you disobey, and then you become insensitive to God. If you're in that state right now, you might be going, oh, this is kind of cool at the church. They sure are amazing worship. But you kind of miss the point, not because you're a horrible person, but because you're insensitive to God. There have been so many times in my life when I'm insensitive to what he has to say to me. I might have been, yesterday at our church, we had a 5 o'clock service, so I went with Kathy to the 5 o'clock service, and I was just distracted. There was a lot of things going on. I was thinking about what I was going to say to you all. I'm on my phone looking up the word purpose during the sermon, right? And Kathy said, "So how was church? What did you think?" I said, "You know, it was okay." And she goes, "Let me quote you. You've often said," and actually she thought it was my quote, but it's actually Soren Kierkegaard, who's a well-known philosopher. "But when you go to church, you shouldn't say, how was it? How was the show? You should say, how did I do?" And I love that Soren Kierkegaard said, when you come to church, it's how did I do? You're participating in a relationship with Jesus. So the singing, the sermon, it's not about that. It's not about what I'm wearing. It's about what you're hearing from the Word of God. See what I'm saying? And so there's not as much, there shouldn't be as much pressure on us pastors. We have all kinds of pressure on that. But again, what she was saying was, I saw you as distracted. I knew you were distracted, so don't be blaming our pastor, which I wasn't. I didn't say anything about him because I love this man. But he, you know, don't be blaming the what else is going on. You were distracted. And so you missed a really good message. So I was being a little insensitive to God. You can be insensitive to God and not be fully, you know, drifting and fully neglecting and whatnot. And then the sixth one is forfeiting your spiritual purpose. Do you know people who have forfeited their spiritual purpose? I don't know even how to explain it in a precise way, because some people that, I mean, we used to use the word falling away. Sure, that works. But there are people who choose to forfeit their spiritual purpose because they don't worship on a regular basis anymore. They've drifted. They're not pursuing, and I'm sorry if this offends you, but they're not pursuing their spiritual purpose because they didn't marry a Christian. And so the Christian, like for example, I was talking to somebody just a while back who was thinking about marrying a non-Christian. This was the non-Christian, I'm not saying they're all evil. I'm just saying the non-Christian stands here, or you stand here and the non-Christian stands there. Which is easier, pulling you down or you pulling them up? So they were marrying a person with potential, but didn't have the potential with a number of other things too. I'm not sure that was the wisest idea. Were they going to forfeit their spiritual purpose? We'll see. I think they're on that process. So again, and I used to say this to kids all the time, because I used to speak to kids, students all the time. And I would say, the decisions you make today will affect you for the rest of your life. Are you making decisions today that will put you in touch with your spiritual purpose, or are you making decisions that will not put you in touch with your spiritual service, or your spiritual purpose? I said service. Same thing, maybe. I don't know. Okay. So I grieve for these people because I think there's a lot of people that are putting so much energy into other things that they're missing the most important thing. But I've got a scripture for you, and I'm going to actually give you a lot of scripture today. Sometimes people will say, you know, Jim, you gave us like two scriptures, but you're going to get a lot of scripture from me today. I love this scripture. It's very famous. Jeremiah 29:11. Somebody needs to hear it, and it's for you. I don't know who you are. It says, for I know the plans for you. Why, there it is, coming up on the screen. For I know the plans for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. That's good news. That's what God wants for every person who's here in this room, who's over in the other part of the church, who's streaming, wherever you are, if you're hearing that, that's God's plan for us. And again, sometimes we don't understand that because we're foggy with it. Plans. God's plans, plans for you to prosper. What does that mean? It doesn't mean that you're going to be the richest person in Glendora. What it means is prosper is more about your life, your family. What I was looking at our Kathy, we have a big birthday happening later in the afternoon. It's Kathy's, my wife. And so the family started showing up. So two daughters who live in Los Angeles came in. I started to say moved in for one night. They came. And we had so much fun going out to dinner at a thing. And then we're going to do a big bash tonight. And then they're going to leave. But I just went, wow, the plans to prosper. I'm prospering. I'm in a time of prospering my own life because of the family and the grandkids and all that kind of good stuff. That's a time of prosper, okay? It has nothing to do with finances, okay? Our ministry is prospering. The ministry I work with is called Homeward. It's in a real prosperous time. It's been in some lousy times. Does that mean that God's hand wasn't on it? No, God's hand was on it. This is just a time right now where there's lots of prosperity, not just about finances, but about ministry and anointing and things like that. So God's plan for you is to prosper. God's plan is not to bring harm on you. You say, fine, what about illness? What about a child who's walked away? Or what about a family member or estrangement or whatever it might be? And I'm saying God's plan is not to harm you. He's not going, I'm going to go get this person. Because some people have a warped view of his purpose is that if you fall away from his purpose, then he punishes you. No, you're punishing yourself. I talk a lot about trust, trusting God's plans. And so what's tough love? Tough love doesn't mean that you shun your kids. Tough love doesn't mean that you punish your kids. Tough love is you allow the circumstances of their poor choices to carry out, and you show empathy. See what I'm saying? So again, that's a key. Plans to give you a future. Some of your futures are long and beautiful. Some of your futures are not going to be perfect, but it's still a good future. See what I'm saying? A purpose. And I love this scripture, and I've always had trouble with this scripture, to be honest with you, but it's found in Romans 8:28. I'm doing the highlights of the Bible here. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Is it possible to have good and have an illness, to have cancer? Yeah, it is. I've had cancer. My wife's had cancer. I'm not saying my cancer is easier than your cancer, probably, or whatever it might be, but it doesn't mean it's perfect, but it can be good. See, is your family perfect? No, but it can be good. It can be right. And so again, we're connecting to a purpose, good for those who love him, it says, called according to his purpose. What is his purpose for your life? Said to a family just, you know, within the last, well, I started, my wife always says, I say just the other day, and then it was like 2 years ago. I think this was around Christmas. I started to say just the other day, but I said to a family, is God's purpose for you to separate the husband and wife and get a divorce? There had not been adultery. There hadn't been other things. They just said it was, you know, we just sort of faded. We're not close anymore. And yet studies show that if somebody in even a terrible marriage, if they'll persevere for 5 years, 78% of them say that their marriage is better off and they were glad they didn't divorce. Okay? So what's God's purpose even in that situation? Here's another scripture on purpose. The Lord has made everything for its purpose. So again, we don't probably think or talk enough about purpose, but when it's in our mind, yeah, the Lord has made everything for its purpose. And I love this scripture. Ephesians 2:10, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do works, good works, which God prepared in advance. You know the word handiwork in the Greek, because the New Testament's written in Greek, is actually can also be translated poetry. Did you know you're God's poetry? You're God's poetry. You are God's poetry. You may not feel like God's poetry today, but you're God's poetry, his handiwork, so that you could do good works. That's your purpose. Good works within your family, good works outside of your family. Throw in a little cash to the to the camp fund, whatever it is. That's part of our purpose. And we have to be in touch with our purpose, and we live out our purpose, and we're going to do a lot better because we're God's poetry. And we're created in Christ Jesus to do good works, okay? That's our purpose. Now, what does it look like? Okay, that's the question for the day, and let's look at it really practically. Number one is we have a goal. And you know what I think the goal is? Make your top priorities your top priority. We're always straying. But make your top priority your top priority. It was Peter Drucker, just from Claremont over here, long gone, but he was a management guru, a business guru, but he always said first things first, last things not at all. So are your top priorities your top priority? So this is a diagram. You can kind of see it here. The words look pretty small, but, so this is my diagram for me, and I actually work through this. You would see it in my journal. I keep a journal, and you would see this in my journal. It says top priority, spiritual. What is my top priority spiritually for now? Marriage, family, mental, social, physical. You can tell I'm not doing so good in the top priorities of physical. Vocation, and just having serious fun. Do I have enough fun in my life? See, we're supposed to. The Bible says a cheerful heart is good medicine. So again, make your top priorities your top priority. So what I'm doing is asking myself two questions regularly. Honestly, it's right at the beginning of my journal, okay? And it goes like this. Am I giving enough attention to the most important priorities in my life, my purpose? And what is the one thing that would benefit me most in each area? So what I do is I take each of those areas, going back to that little diagram. You can create your own diagram, priorities, and then just put whatever your priorities are. See? And am I giving enough time and attention to those priorities? And what is the one thing, not the 12 things, you'll never get that done, but what's the one thing that keeps me going with that? See? In fact, priorities with my family. My three daughters are now, in their 30s. And, they have their lives, and they're busy, and they have all kinds of things going on. Two live in L.A. One lives right by us in San Clemente. And I decided I'm going to date my daughters once a month. And I can't believe how hard that is to do because of their busyness. I mean, I'm sort of busy, but it's their busyness. But I said, hey, you guys open for, and Becca and Heidi, who live in L.A., I kind of sometimes do it on the same day. I'll do breakfast with Becca, and then I do lunch with Heidi, and I'm like, oh my gosh, but you know what? It's so good. It's not perfect. Sometimes I don't get my agendas taken care of because I'm always the agenda guy, but that's a priority for me. So do the one thing. So, I rather doubt that there is one person, there's no one in this room that would say my top priority is watching more and reading more news. Or spending more time on social media. And yet, my guess is that a lot of people watch or read too much news. I'm not saying I'm not saying news is bad. I'm saying, that we have a new possible war that started taking place yesterday. That's interesting. We probably need to look at what Iran is doing and whatnot. I get it. But do we really need to watch it over and over again, 24 hours? Do we really need to just keep scrolling because we're depressed or we're angry or we're bored or whatever it might mean? And what we thought was going to be two fun reels, we've now watched, 47 reels, some we've seen before. Seriously? See? And again, I'm saying that because those kinds of things can be me. So if you are going to make sure that you're leaning into your purpose, you've got to do the one thing. What is the one thing? Now, the Bible says something very interesting in Matthew, and this is the living version of the Bible. But in Matthew, and then I'm going to go to that, find that, or maybe the scripture's not there. Here it is. Live one day at a time. Live one day at a time. That's Jesus. Now, Jesus said that in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. He said, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these other things are going to come. That's 33, verse 33. But in verse 34, it says, and live one day at a time. So if you've ever been in recovery, you know that's what you do. Some people in recovery need to live 1 hour, 1 minute at a time. But the way we do it is what is that one thing? So we've got a diagram up here. And the scripture is on that diagram. There you go. This is a business diagram. So this isn't, coming from you know, some Bible diagram, but it says, look, you got all these multiple projects. You moms and dads who are juggling like crazy, you know this. And so we have all these multiple projects going on, and we put our energy in all of those, and we never make it to success. But if you have one project at a time, we make it to success. I don't care if that's doing the dishes. I don't care if it's doing the laundry, cleaning the house, whatever you got in business. But for me, spiritually, I need to work on my top priorities. I can't keep working on everything because I don't have the capacity to then be successful with my purpose. Okay. Now, there's a movie. I'm into movies today for some reason. I love movies. And you've probably seen this clip or you've probably seen this movie, and you're going to get some great advice from a guy with a cigarette in his mouth. Here it is.
Then you think 2 weeks up here will have time for you. None of you get it. Do you know what the secret of life is?
No, what?
This.
Your finger?
One thing. Just one thing.
That's great, but what's the one thing?
That's what you gotta figure out.
Amazing that they're riding on a horse and he goes, the one thing, with his cigarette dangling from his mouth. He dies in the movie. If that's spoiler alert if you didn't see the movie. But what is the one thing? You know what I think the one thing is? I think the one thing is a right relationship with God and then a right relationship with your family. I think the one thing is making sure that you're in touch with your purpose. And then you feel God's presence when you are running in his purpose. And you feel God's pleasure, see. But we get distracted. Man, are we a distracted world. What are your distractions? You know, you can even have attractive distractions. I know somebody who, their attractive distraction is they work out so much, and I'm not saying this is bad, because I think working out is very important. The Bible says your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. But they work out so much that they can't come on Sunday because Sunday is their run day. So they don't go to church because they can't find another time to do their long run than Sunday morning. And so that's an attractive distraction. It's not are they evil people? No, but they're not living within their purpose. How much time do you spend on things like social media? Funny, when I mentioned the word social media, some of you went, yeah, I do a lot of that. I'm not talking about your kids. I know they're addicted. What about you? See. And so how much time do we spend on social media? Here, watch this video.
Really?
Really? Really?
I mean, really? Do you really need to be on social media that much? Oh my goodness, we probably don't. So it's an attractive distraction because it keeps us from something, you know, greater or more important. Do you know what the word fubbing means? Fubbing is P-H-U-B-B-I-N-G. So fubbing is you're fubbing your spouse, you're fubbing your kids, you're fubbing your friends, you're fubbing your parents. And what it means is the interference of technology in relationships today. So I took this from the dictionary. It's fubbing is the practice of ignoring one's companion or companions in order to pay attention to one's phone or mobile device. These people were fubbing. Well, if we're not careful, we're fubbing. We're putting too much energy into one thing and we're missing out on the purpose. I don't know what your time wasters are. I know what mine are. Name your time wasters, because we all have time wasters. I mean, I'm busy, and actually, I get a lot done in a day, but I still have too many time wasters. And so, we have to be careful with that. And then lastly, I would simply say, slow down. I've actually talked about this. I kind of go back and see what I've spoken on here at Grace before, and I've talked a little bit about this, so I won't spend a lot of time. But I love this quote by Cleo Wade. When you give yourself more time, you give yourself more life. It's that simple. And some of us just need to simply slow down. One of the biggest problems in America is this breathless pace in which we live our lives. We're too busy. Busy people are broken people. Busy families sometimes are broken families. And so in this fast-paced life, then we can't find our purpose because we're looking at too many things out there. Someone once said, nothing is accomplished in a stampede. Nothing is accomplished in a stampede, except getting out of the way, hopefully, of the horses. Hurry is a form of violence, so says John Mark Comer. It's violence to your soul. And so if you want violence to your soul, then you be in a hurry. And so I've kind of helped think for my own self, and I'll close with this. This idea of what I'm going to call the solitude, stillness, silence diagram, okay? And there it is, yeah. So do you have enough solitude in your life, stillness in your life, and silence in your life? Now, I'm an extrovert, so none of that stuff really charges me, like, you know, being around a bunch of people and talking shallow to everybody about the Dodgers and the Lakers and, you know, whatever else is going on. My wife lives in the center of that in a beautiful way because she that's where she gets her energy. But what I'm saying is, for to find purpose in your life, you're going to have to slow down. Now, again, I'm not saying you move to Wisconsin and live in a commune. I'm saying you figure it out here and now in Southern California, one of the busiest places in the world. I'm saying you do it in the middle of your mortgages and you do it in the middle of all the whatever else you're involved in. And for me, I want to give you a simple way to keep you from drifting, okay, daily. So find solitude, silence, and stillness daily. Do you have a regular time with God? Basically, if you have a, in 1983, I realize some of you weren't born then, but in 1983, I made a commitment to Jesus to spend 20 minutes a day reading through the Bible. And so I've read through the Bible since 1983 every year. That doesn't make me super spiritual. There are times when I've read it and I don't remember one thing I read. But the discipline of spending daily time with God helps me keep my purpose. Because I'm reminded on a daily basis by looking at God's word that this is my purpose. See, and my purpose is within the words of Scripture. Then weekly. So every week I take some time away, and it's usually 2 or 3 hours for me. That's a long time for me to be silent and have some solitude, right? It's just hard. I'm like, okay. And I live by the beach. I'll go, even if it's cold, I'll go sit there. I'll bring my Bible. I'll do an extended time. I'm reading a book right now, so I'll read this book that's a real, you know, kind of more spiritual purpose type book. Do you do that? Can you do that? So actually, I'm saying we're all too busy, and now I'm saying, would you be willing to spend 20 minutes every day? Would you be willing to invest once a week in some time? For Kathy, when our kids were little, I took the kids out for donuts. Not good for our physical health, but really good for Kathy because she was away. You know what? My kids still want to do donuts. They're adults, and they still want to go out with, they only think of me with the donuts because Kathy isn't as much of a donut person. Today, I was looking for a place to, I went to Starbucks, and I came here, and then I went farther than I'd planned, and I see the Donut Man or whatever it was called. I was like, oh my gosh. Well, I guess it's not Saturday, so I can't go. But I love donuts. And so I'm not saying if I ate donuts every day, that'd not be a good idea. But part of that weekly time is to take time, extended time away, and then yearly. So in May, I'll be gone for 3 nights. That is a lot of work on Kathy's part because she's on it alone. But I'll be out, and I'm not going to do extra work. I'm not going to plan my next book or my next speaking thing. I'm just going to spend time with God. I do it once a year. I look forward to it. I take long walks. I wish I could say how sexy it is and how, you know, God meets me with flash of lights. No. What it does is I've been drifting, and it's my course correction. It's my yearly course correction. So if you want to find your purpose, quite possibly it's to slow down and on a daily basis spend some time with God, listening, interacting, keeping the word of God present in your life, maybe a weekly time. And if you can't do 2 hours or 3 hours, there's no magic number, so spend 25 minutes instead of the 20. And then on a yearly basis. That's been a good thing for me, okay? Your spiritual purpose. Don't forfeit your spiritual purpose. There's way too many people around us in our lives who are forfeiting their spiritual purpose. And in forfeiting their spiritual purpose, they're settling for second best with their life. Let's pray. Almighty God, thank you for giving us purpose. And thank you for many of the scriptures that we looked at today, but especially that you know the plans for us and that those are plans to prosper and not harm us, plans to give us hope and a future. There's people in this room right now that desperately need hope and a future. So I pray, Lord, that as we leave today's worship, that we wouldn't leave your presence or your purpose, and you'd give us some good ideas on what to do with it. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Thank you. To come and see about me, and why is this life so hard, and why do you seem so far? But if this cup will pass, help me to stay steadfast. Let your will be done. You get the glory from this.
Please give the glory from me.